So next concept that we are going to talk about is differentiation of a determinant. Now, determinant, if you see, I'll just take a very small example of a 2x2. Let's say if I have F1, G1, F2, G2 as our determinant. Okay. Let's say I call this as delta x. So here F1 and G1 are functions of x, or can be constants also. Okay. Now, when we expand this determinant, we get F1 G2 minus F2 G1. Correct. If somebody says differentiate this determinant with respect to x, what do I do? I'll apply product rule individually to these two. Isn't it? So if you look at the first one, it becomes F1 G2 dash plus F1 dash G2 minus this becomes, let me put brackets, this becomes F2 dash G1 plus F2 G1 dash. Correct? Okay. Now what I will do here is I will restructure it like this. F1 G2 minus F2 G1 dash. F1 dash G2. So I've taken this term and I've clubbed up with this. Okay. Plus the non-tick mark terms, that is F1 G2 dash minus F2 dash G1, I will club up like this. Okay. If you see these two terms very, very carefully, they themselves are actually determinants having this as the first row, this as the second row for the first one. So for this one, I have written it in the form of a determinant. Please confirm whether this is fine. And for the second one, that is for this guy, you can also write it as a determinant. F1, G1, F2 dash, G2 dash. Correct. So what does this tell us? Sorry, this one is slightly above, so it has to be down here. Yeah. What does this tell us? When you're trying to differentiate a determinant, we can do the differentiation like this, as you have done it here, row wise. But let me tell you, you can also perform it column wise. Okay. So if you do a different type of a pairing over here, you'll end up getting a column wise for the same. That means you can also do it like this. I'll write it down over here. F1 dash F2 dash G1 G2 plus F1 F2 G1 dash G2 dash. That means either you do it row wise or you do column wise, the result is going to be the same. As you can see here, F1 dash G2 minus F2 dash G1. Right? It is basically clubbing this term with this term. See here, F1 dash G2 minus F2 dash G1. So it is clubbing these two terms. Okay, so if you make a pair of these two and these two, you'll end up getting this form. Is that clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so let me expand this, or let me extend this to even a 3x3. So you can follow the same thing. Similar approach can be followed even for higher order determinants. Okay. Now it is your call. You want to differentiate it row wise, but remember, when you're differentiating it by any one of the approach, you can only differentiate a row or a column one by one. You can't differentiate everything at the same time. So as you can see, I've differentiated first row, kept the second column as it is, then plus keep the first row as it is, then differentiate the second column, a second row. Okay. Same with column wise operation also. So if you're doing it, do first column, keep the second column as it is, plus keep the first column as it is, differentiate the second column. Okay. Now again, many people ask me, sir, why do we need it? We can expand it and differentiate it now. What is the big need for this particular approach? Again, as I told you, there may be some complicated determinants. You cannot expand it and then differentiate. It's better to differentiate it before you expand it. So in such cases, the differentiation of determinant method would become very, very handy. Will become very, very convenient for you. Okay, let's take a few questions, then we'll understand this approach in a much deeper way. Let's say, okay, I take this question. Question is, find f dash 0. Now, as you can see, if you expand this determinant and then try to differentiate, it would be too tricky, it would be too lengthy for you. No, Ruchir, it's not that. Correct, Ruchir Parikh. Correct, Advik. Ruchir Singh, it is not the answer that you have stated. No, it is not even that. Sure, take your time. No, Abhiram, that's not correct. Check your working again. Correct, Chaitanya. No, Param. That's not right. Okay, guys, let's discuss this. Let's discuss this. See, when you're differentiating the first row, second row elements, you can directly substitute zero because you'll have three determinants and ultimately you'll have to substitute zero in place of x, correct? So this will become a zero, this will become a one, this will become a zero, this will become a zero, this will become a zero, and this will become a zero. So anything that comes here, I don't care because the last row is zero. So this will be completely zero. This will be completely zero. Correct. Next. If let's say I differentiate the second row, then also I'll get completely zero because the third row will still be zero. Okay. So this zero will come again. The only respite that we'll get is when we are differentiating the third row. Okay. Now see, for third row, I'll put zero in the first and the second row. So this will be 1, 0, -1, 0, 1, 0. Derivative of this will be 2 sine 2x. That will give me a 2. This is 0 and this will be 0. Okay. Let's expand this with respect to the last row. So 2, 0, -1, +1. So this will become f dash 0. That's nothing but 2. So guys, one thing I would like to tell you, don't unnecessarily solve those determinants where you realize one of the rows is going, or one of the columns is going to become a 0. So as you can see, column number 3 will be 0 when you put x as 0, right? Post differentiation, when you're putting x as 0, column number 3 will be completely 0, at least for the first and the second one, right? So why to even expand it? Param, you need to practice differentiation first.
So I made sine 2x cos x.
Okay, let's take another one. F, G, and H are three polynomials of degree 2. Prove that this is a constant polynomial. Easy.
So the last row yes, will done. Be constant from zero.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this is a very easy question. See, if you differentiate it, let's say if I do phi dash x, when you differentiate the first row, keeping the other two same, you would realize that the first and the second will become the same, right? So it'll happen something like this. Okay, so this guy will become a zero. Okay. When you differentiate the second row, keeping the first same, I think the first, second, and the third will become the same. So this will become a zero. And when you differentiate the third row, since it's a degree 2 polynomial, we can say that the last row would be all 0, 0, 0. Because the third derivative of a second degree polynomial has to be zero. Correct. That means this is also zero. So if your phi dash x is zero, that means this polynomial is a constant polynomial. Simple as that. No problem with this. No issues. Let's take the next question. G of x is given as this. F of x is a polynomial of degree less than 3. Prove that the derivative of g will be this determinant divided by, this is a division symbol. Okay. Okay, this is not a easy question actually. It requires a bit of thinking. So they're saying that the derivative of this term can be expressed like this determinant divided by this determinant. Okay. Now, first of all, can we break g of x into partial fractions? Now, is it a candidate for partial fractions? For that, the degree of the numerator must be lesser than degree of the denominator. Is it that way? Yes, because they have mentioned that it is degree less than 3. Okay. So I'm going to break this up as a partial fraction. So how I'm going to break this as a partial fraction? So let's check it out. So this term, I'll break it up as a by x minus a, b by x minus b, and c by x minus c. Okay. Now, if you take the LCM and all, this will become A times X minus B, X minus C, B times X minus A, X minus C, and C times X minus A, X minus B, X minus B. Okay. And you're comparing it with F of X. Okay. So if you want to get an A, the obvious substitution is put X as A. Correct. I hope you have exposure to partial fractions, right? We have done this in integration as well. So if I put x as a, this will become fa, whereas these two terms will vanish. And I will end up getting a times a minus c as f of a. That means your a, which is your the numerator part of x minus a will be f of a by a minus b a minus c. Am I right? Okay. Similarly, I'll not waste too much time. I can see a trend over here. Similarly, I can say b will be f of b by b minus a b minus c. And similarly, c will be f of c by c minus a c minus b. Correct? Any questions so far? Okay, Richard. Okay. So when you put it over here, you would realize you have written something like this: f a x minus a minus b a minus c plus b will be f b x minus b b minus a b minus c, and c will be f c by x minus c a minus b a minus c. Oh, sorry. I was wondering, I wrote something wrong. Yeah, C minus A, C minus B. I looked at the top one by mistake. Anyways, can I take 1 by A minus B, A minus, 1 by A minus B, B minus C, and C minus A common? Okay. If I do that, correct me if I'm wrong. The first term will become f of a into c minus b by x minus a. Correct. So from this term, if you take 1 by a minus b, b minus c, c minus a. Remember, there was an a minus c here. So if you're taking a c minus a, this will become up ulta and go on the numerator, right? Okay. Similarly, what happened to this term? So b minus a has been taken out as a minus b. Okay. And b minus c is b minus c. So this will go and multiply as a minus c on the top, right? Correct. Similarly here, fc, you have taken this as ulta and this as same. So b minus a will go and multiply here. Correct me if I'm wrong. Okay. Guys and girls both, what does this remind you of?
So the 111 ABC.
Yes.
Determinant.
Right. And they have written it here, but slightly in a deviated fashion. Probably they have written negative.
They like interchange the columns.
They interchange it. So let me do one thing. As of now, let me park it as it is. We can do something with this. Can I write this as a determinant which has got 1A? Basically, I'm taking this as one term and C minus B as another term. So F of A by X minus A. And this must have a C minus B. So there will be a 1 here. There will be a B here. And there will be a C here. And there will be a 1 here. So that's why this term is obtained. See, I'll explain you what I did. This term is obtained when you are expanding with respect to, let's say, the third column. And you are multiplying this guy with C minus B. That's its cofactor, right? So that's how you end up getting the first term. Similarly, this will become FB by X minus B. So when you're expanding it, this will become this into C minus A with a negative sign. That will give you A minus C. So this last element of row 3 will be FC by X minus C. Is there anybody who is feeling trouble in understanding this? Let me know. If at all you are feeling trouble, just expand this determinant with respect to column 3. Expand this determinant with respect to column 3. You'll end up getting the whole this part. Check one.
So now when you differentiate, 2 will give 0 and the last one will give a minus sign, then comma will say.
Absolutely. Basically, it was a planned move when I look at this expression, x minus a whole square. Okay, so I thought of this. It is not like I'm doing something in the dark. I was actually having an eye on what we want to get. So this is your g of x finally. So when you differentiate g of x, as Ruchir rightly said, since the first, see, constant will not be affected. Constant will remain constant. It will not be changing. Okay. But what will happen when you're differentiating it, let's differentiate it column wise. The first column will be completely zero. So I don't need to write it. In the second determinant, the second column will be completely zero. I don't need to write it. In third determinant, you'll have 1, 1, 1. And you will have A, B, C. And the derivative of this will be minus F of A, X minus A whole square. Minus F of B, X minus B whole square. And minus F of C, X minus C whole square. And now we understand why they have switched the order of the denominator over here. So basically they have removed a negative sign from here. Okay. And they have placed it over here. And ideally this guy should have been one by determinant. How they have written it? They have written it column wise. Oh yeah, column wise. So ideally it should have been 1, 1, 1, A, B, C, A square, B square, C square. But now that they want to get rid of this negative sign, they swap the position of the first column and the third column. So let's drop this negative sign. Just swap these two positions. And there you go. This is what you wanted to prove. Done. Okay, not an easy question, I would say. This will be probably a JE Advanced kind of a question. Why am I writing prove that? I should write hence proved. Is that fine? Any question, any concerns, please do let me know. Any step that you want me to revisit again, do let me know. Okay. Let's take one more question and then we'll move on to integration of determinants. That's not a very happening concept, integration of determinants, but still I'll surprise you off. Question is, there is a determinant, there's a determinant like this. Okay, so we have a determinant like this. Okay, question is find the coefficient of x in this determinant. Let me call it as delta x. Find the coefficient of x in this determinant. No, Advik, that's not the right answer. See, basically, this is going to result into a polynomial only, something like this. Correct? Let's say it's an nth degree polynomial. Okay. If you want to get coefficient of x, how will you get it? Can I say coefficient of x will be nothing but it will be, let's say I call this determinant as delta x. So a1 will be derivative of delta x at 0, isn't it? Because when you differentiate, a0 goes for a toss. You'll have a1 remaining and then other terms will have an x in it. So if you put a 0, all the other terms containing x will go off. So what is the question actually asking you? The question is actually asking you delta dash 0. That's it. Yes, Ruchir, that's correct. Correct, Chaitanya. It's an easy question, guys. Very easy question. I mean, you can do it verbally also. Correct, Param. Correct, Ruchir Parikh. Chalo, guys. If you differentiate it and put x as 0, remember, let's say if you're differentiating the first row, okay, second and third row will not be affected, right? But when you're putting 0, won't it become 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1? That means row number 2 and row number 3 will become identical, correct? So when you're differentiating it, I'll just try to write it. Something will come over here. I mean, if I want, I can write it as a1, b1, a1, b2, a1, b3. But I see a 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1 coming over here. So anyway, this will kill the whole determinant. Okay. Similarly, for the second one, you will have 1, 1, 1, right? Something will come over here, a2, b1, a2, b2, a2, b3, and again 1, 1, 1. So row number 1 and row number 3 are identical. That will kill the whole determinant. Okay. And finally, you will have 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. And you have a3, b1, a3, b2, and a3, b3. So that will still give you 0 because row number 2 and row number 1 are identical. That means delta dash x or delta dash 0 is 0, which is actually a1 equal to 0. So there will be 0 coefficient along with x. Is this clear, everybody? Is this clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now let's take up the concept of integration of determinants. Integration of determinants. This concept is a very, very narrow one because this works only in certain cases. So if let's say you have a determinant, which is a function of x, but only one row or any one column. Okay. If multiple rows and multiple columns have functions of x, then this method will not work. Okay. So this theory says that if you have a determinant which is having any one row or any one column as functions of x, and if you're integrating that determinant with respect to x from, let's say, limit a to b, okay, then it is as good as integrating that row which has got functions of x in it, or that column which has got functions of x in it. Okay, rest other rows and columns would remain as it is. Rest other rows and columns would remain as it is. Now, a good question arises here. What will we do? What will we do if multiple rows or multiple columns have functions of x in them? In that case, you need to expand the determinant and integrate. Okay, so please note, if more than one rows slash column are expressed as functions of x. As functions of x, then delta x must be expanded and then integrated. Okay. Now, why does this happen? Is because let's say if you have only one row as a function of x and you expand it, you would realize that in such a case, you will always end up getting f of x along with some constant, g of x along with some constant. Correct? I hope you know the constants. For f of x, the constant will be qn minus mr. Okay. For g of x, the constants will be rl minus pn, like that. And h of x will also have a constant. Now, when you're integrating it, the constants will anyways not participate. So you'll end up integrating f, g, and h only, which is as good as saying this. Right? That means the other two rows are not getting affected. But if you have multiple rows or columns written in functions of x, then you'll have a product of two functions of x coming up. And for that, the integration has to be done in a different way. You either have to apply integration by parts or any other method that you know of to do it. So this will not be as simple as we have it in the case where any one row or any one column is made as a function of x. Okay. Because of this restriction, it doesn't find its use. You know, many questions are not asked on this. So it's a very, very, you can say, simple concept. Let's take a simple example for the same, and then we'll close the session. Let's say, I have a determinant. Very simple question I'll give you. Just to apply the formula. Okay, let's say this is a function of x. Evaluate integral of delta x from 0 to 1. Dear all, those who are following SK Goel from Arihant, let me tell you, they have given something called Wallis formula and all under integration, under determinants. I don't know whether you have the new edition with you, but I will not be doing Wallis formula in determinants. I'll be doing it under definite integrals. Okay, very good, Ruchir. Rahul. Chaitanya Mahit, good. Yeah, that's correct. It's very simple. Let's do that. So if you have to integrate, remember the other rows which are made up of constants will not be affected. This will become x square by 2 from 0 to 1, x cube by 3 from 0 to 1, x4 by 4 from 0 to 1. So that will give you ABC, 643, half, one third, one fourth. Half, one third, one fourth. So let's multiply the row number 3 with a 12, and we can write it like this: 12, ABC, 643. Row 2 and row 3 have become identical. So this will be collapsing and the answer is 0. And the answer is 0. Is that fine? Now, since it involves integration having limits, we'll not be able to take many questions on this before we do definite integrals. So we'll start with definite integrals in the next class. Then probably we can solve many more questions under this. Okay. Now I'll take a break because we have officially done the determinants and we have to start with Cramer's rule. We have officially done with the differentiation and integration and we'll have to start with Cramer's rule. So after the break, we'll talk about Cramer's rule. That will take another hour or so.